And those of us, obviously, who have a lot of reported income pay a lot in taxes, or can certainly. But the richest clearly don't.
What do you guys think about this whole ProPublica, speaking of wealth inequality, this ProPublica leak of tax records? Somebody inside the IRS, or it was hacked, we don't know. The tax records, many going back many years, of 3,000 of the wealthiest Americans. And ProPublica has slowly started to digest and issue news reports about them. And it shows that, you know, in some years, guys like Bezos paid no tax whatsoever, were able to take huge deductions. You know, at one point, actually, Bezos, in a year where he made, you know, kind of like $1 billion, was able to claim he made nothing and then made so little or made negative dollars that he got a $4,000 tax credit that's typically reserved for people.
One thing I'll say is I think these stories have highlighted just an incredible ability to shift the narrative and create a different kind of dialogue around taxation. Because as we all know, the principle of taxation in the United States is that you are taxed on income. And income is a recognized gain, meaning when you sell an asset for cash or for some other asset,
then or you do a job,
or you do a job, and then you get paid. You get that cash that you can now go use to go buy something or to do whatever you want to do with. That is the transaction moment that you get taxed on. And everyone's saying, "Well, this guy's a billionaire. He has these billions of dollars. He paid no taxes. He didn't necessarily make billions of dollars of income that year. His stock value may have gone up billions of dollars, but if we all taxed each other when our stock values went up each year, and we didn't get a rebate when our stocks went down, people would feel pretty upset. The average American, the average person would probably feel pretty upset if they got taxed every time their stock portfolio went up, and then they didn't get to have a rebate when their stock portfolio went down. So the principle of taxation is such that when you sell those shares and you ultimately generate income, that's when you get taxed. But the narrative is very quickly shifting where people are like, oh, this guy's a billionaire. Stated, you know, he didn't pay any taxes. They don't say anything about how much income he actually made. And a lot of these guys don't need income because
they have a dollar salary. They
effectively have a credit card. One way to think about it is wealthy people have a credit card, as Chamath pointed out, because they can buy everything on loan. They can buy everything they want on credit because down the road, everyone knows you guys have billions of dollars.
So if you take a loan and then you use that loan to actually invest, the United States tax law says that all that interest you pay is deductible as well. And so the arbitrage that you find yourself in, it's like you have these assets, you go to a bank, they'll lend it against, because they want, you know, what is the bank's job? A bank's job is to generate interest, right? So, you know,
they want big fish as customers.
Right. And so, and then part of the tax code is that it's tax deductible. And so it's one of these things that I think structurally gets people very confused about what's right or wrong, but it happens, and it happens.
That when somebody lives on a credit card, like one day that credit card comes due, and it's not a problem for Bezos because Amazon stocks just keeps going up and up and up, but you will occasionally hear about some rich person going broke. And the reason is always that they took on too much debt, and then their stock price went down, and all of a sudden they owe more than the value of the collateral, and then they're just done.
And so you
do, exactly. So you do take a big risk.
Forced liquidation.
When you live on margin, you are taking a big risk. Most people don't do that. Most people who have gains will eventually cash out. They'll do that by selling their company, or they'll sell a piece of their stock. They'll have a stock selling plan, and then they pay tax.
And I feel like it's really unfair how, I don't want to say it's unfair because people get really riled up when rich people aren't paying taxes. But it's interesting to me how the narrative has been kind of very quickly reframed without the specificity of the income that was generated by these individuals. And they're just saying, look, this person has all this wealth. They didn't pay any taxes, without actually recognizing that this person may have had an income generating event earlier in their life, which they did pay taxes on, or they will have an income generating event later in their life, which they will pay taxes on. And so the truth is a little bit more nuanced than I think, you know, the very quick kind of soundbitey press stories kind of indicate. And it's been really interesting to watch how many people get so riled up and frothy about this moment. And I get that we all, you know, everyone kind of dislikes wealthy people.
With Bezos, take for example, and look, by the way, maybe he should be paying more tax in other ways, but with respect to his Amazon stock, he built this machine called Amazon. It's this machine that makes all of our lives better, for the most part, in terms of the delivery of goods and services. You know, you press a button, somebody shows up the next day. So he builds this incredible machine. He owns a piece of it. He's merely holding on to his ownership in that machine. But the way that the public market is valuing that machine keeps going up and up and up. But to Freeberg's point, he hasn't recognized more income. He doesn't have more cash in his bank account. And so should he be paying taxes every year?
Well, I mean, here's
year?
The thing. If you change the rule, hold on. If you change the rule, Chamath, correct me if I'm wrong here, and you said you have to pay on the gain, then somebody who bought a house in 1980 and it appreciated 100x in California by the time they were 70 and they bought it in their 30s, they would get caught up in this wealth tax or paying for it as they go. The appreciation.
This mechanism exists. Now, Jason, you said a key thing. This mechanism exists at all parts of the tax code. So yes, a billionaire can basically go to JP Morgan or Goldman Sachs or Morgan Stanley, you know, get a margin loan on their stock and live their life. But individual folks who are not billionaires can do that via a HELOC on their home. And a lot of people do that as well. They take home equity lines of credit and they use that to forward finance things as well. The difference is that because the quantums are so much bigger, you have this ability for rich people to accelerate their wealth creation in a way that normal folks don't. So I'll give you another example. So one example that I just spoke about is you basically take a loan instead of selling things, right? You use that to make investments. All of that interest is tax deductible, number one. Number two is even if you don't need to do that, you can just take a loan on a small percentage of your capital, reinvest that, again, pay the interest, and now you're running implicitly a little bit of leverage. And just to give you a sense of it, there's a really great study by AQR, I think is the name of the hedge fund. And they reverse engineered Buffett's returns. And what they saw was that Buffett ran about 20 to 30% levered his entire career. And the way he did that was synthetically by the float of Geico. The point I'm trying to make is even the best investors in the world prove that a small amount of margin and leverage is the key between being average and being the best in the world. And if he needed that, let's be honest, we all need that. And again, we all can't have that. It's only available to a few. And so I'm not saying that the rules are wrong, but the rules do stifle the ability to basically move up and move down that curve. It's clear how often people move down. People get stopped out. They get margined out. Happens all the time. It's very hard to see examples of people moving up. It's because it's harder and harder to get that first little bit of capital that then you can go and run with.